Now let's have a look at Spring. Spring is a really huge set of frameworks and tools. We will look only at a very small part in this course. And we will focus on things related to web applications. Actually, we will not see at all everything related to web applications either, but we'll see one way to create a reasonably simple web application using the Spring frameworks. That means we will focus on two Spring projects, namely Spring Boot and Spring Web MVC. Spring Boot, as the name indicates, is responsible for starting the Spring containers and wiring everything together. Since Spring is so huge and also very flexible, it can be quite complicated to configure all the frameworks and things used in the application. And this is the task of the Spring Boot project. The other one we look at, Spring Web MVC, is for creating web applications. And the Spring MVC is a framework using blocking communication. It has the architecture of Homework 1. There's also another Spring project called Spring WebFlux. That is also a framework for web applications, but it uses non-blocking sockets. It has the architecture of Homework 2. Now I'll introduce another Spring framework, namely the Spring IOC container, which is the very core of Spring. Actually, that was the first thing developed. That's where Spring actually started, with this container. The idea is that everything, every class or object or framework or whatever, can be represented as a bean, and the bean is essentially a Java object, more or less any Java object. More about this soon. And anything can be plugged in. So beans can be plugged in into the IOC container and connected together. So it essentially means that we can inject anything into anything and make anything collaborate with anything. So that makes it very flexible. Okay, so now we'll have a closer look at how this actually works. IOC means inversion of control. And the idea is that it's not objects themselves that creates dependencies, for example by creating new objects with the new operator. Instead, it's the container, the IOC container, that creates all objects and then glues them together, injects them into each other. IOC, inversion of control, is also known as dependency injection. It's more or less the same thing. They can be used interchangeably. Inversion of control means that it's the container that injects objects' dependencies into objects. With dependencies, I mean references. So inversion of control implies dependency injection. Say that object A needs a reference to object B. It will call a method in object B. Then it's not the object A that creates the object B, but instead it defines its dependency on object B with an annotation. The container then will create the instance of object B and will inject into the calling object. So all objects are managed by the container. Objects will never use the new operator to create other objects. And there is first the IOC container. Say that we have an object of some class. This object has a field which defines a reference to some other object it needs. Let's call that other object service. It needs to invoke this service. Normally we would write perhaps new service here. But using the IOC container, this is not how it works. We will not create the object like this. Instead, we'll declare the need for this object with an annotation, and that annotation is auto-wired, which tells the IOC container to inject this object of class service. The IOC container will see, a field annotated auto-wired, I need to inject the dependency here. So then the IOC container will create the object of class service and inject that dependency. The service field will now contain a reference to the service object. The promise of the IOC container is that whenever the service reference is used, it will contain a reference to an actual instance of the service class. As you can see, object lifecycle is completely managed by the IOC container. We do not create objects with a new keyword. There are special cases when new might be appropriate, but whenever you write new, you should hear a warning bell sounding. Am I now doing the work of the IOC container? And it's very crucial that you let the IOC container handle this, because it's only objects created by the IOC container that can be subjected to dependency injection like this. If we did create the service object using the new operator, then the IOC container would not know about the service object and would not be able to inject dependencies from service. Say that the service depends on some third object. Then it's only if the IOC container created the service object that this dependency can be injected. If we did create the service object using the new keyword here, then the IOC container would not be able to handle this dependency. Now we've seen how objects are created and stored in the IOC container, but when are they removed from the container and discarded? Well, that depends on their scope. So all objects have a certain scope, and the scope has a specified lifetime. And when the lifetime of a scope is over, all objects with that scope are discarded. Let's stop here a short time and have a closer look at scopes, because this scope concept is very important. I'm not saying it works exactly this way, but a good way to visualize scopes is to think about a scope as a set of objects inside the IOC container. So the thing is that all objects created by the IOC container have a scope, and that means that they live inside the set used for that scope. So as an example, we consider the session scope, which lasts for the lifetime of an HTTP session. And then there was also the singleton scope, and the lifetime of that is the lifetime of the entire application, so it's never discarded. Then there is also, for example, the request scope, which has the lifetime of just one single HTTP request. And there are other scopes as well that will not be covered here. Now let's see how this actually works. So say that the program is executing, and at some point a particular object is needed, and objects of this class have session scope. So then the IOC container will look in the set of the session scoped objects, look in here. Okay, there is no such object, the set is currently empty. Then a new object is created, and when it is created, it is also inserted into the scope set, in this case the session scope set, and the object is also used at the point in the program where it was needed. Okay, later, at another point in time, an object of this same class is again needed. The IOC container will again look in the session scope set, because the class never changed its scope, and now it will find the object, it's this object, and then it will use that object at the point in the program where it was needed this time. So this means it's always the same object that is used within the lifetime of the scope. Okay, so then the scope's lifetime ends, the HTTP session ends, for example. Then the entire scope set is discarded and thrown away. Okay, so now there is no session scope set at all. So the next time an object of this class is needed, the IOC container will see that there is no object. In fact, there is no set at all. An empty set is created. There is still no such object, so now a new object must be created again, and it all starts over. So this way we can be sure that there will never be more than one object of the same class during the time the scope of the class exists. And this is very important, because for example in web applications it is difficult to keep track of objects between requests and to know if it is the same object or different objects that we are using in different requests. So this way we let the IOC container handle object scopes for us, and we let the IOC container take care of providing us with the object we actually want. If it's the same object to be used between different requests, then the object might have session scope or singleton scope. If we want a new object for each request, then the object should have request scope. But remember that this works only for objects created by IOC. If we write new and create objects that way, then the IOC container will not have created the object, and in fact the IOC container will not at all be aware of the object. Writing new and creating objects manually actually means we kick out the entire IOC handling of that object. Now there might be occasions when new is appropriate, when we want to create objects ourselves, but you should be very suspicious if you ever write new, and make sure you're really doing the correct thing. Do you really want to kick out the IOC container and handle this object completely manually? Right, so now we know all about scopes. Now it's time to have a look at some other features of the IOC container. So let's return to our previous image of some class calling a service. The IOC container can insert proxies, because it's the IOC container that is in charge of all objects and of all calls between objects. The green line here, the dependency between some class and the service, don't have to look like this. There's nothing that says that the IOC container has to add a dependency or a reference, if you wish, directly to the service object. Instead, it can insert its own object in between, because control returns to the IOC container whenever call is made from an object to any other object. The green line passed through the container here, so the container can insert any other object and do whatever it wishes there. So it might look like this, and it often does, in fact. Here is an object inserted by the container. Let's call it a service proxy. That has a reference to the service. So the reference from some class object is in fact not to the service class, but to another class generated by the container that in turn will call the service. So say that in the service class there is a method called, for example, a met, and in the code here somewhere in some class there is a call, and the proxy that is generated by the IOC container will have the same method. When the call is made here from some class to a met, that call is made to this method here, which can do whatever work the container thinks is necessary at this point. For example, handle transactions, do some security check, write to the logs, whatever non-functional requirement the container must perform. And then this one will call the actual method, emet, which then will return. Again, the proxy method can do whatever is required, commit the transaction, or whatever. And then control returns back up here to some class. So this fact that it's the container that is in charge of objects and that glues them together gives the container this possibility to insert proxies. So that's one big advantage of using such a container. Another advantage is that dependencies are resolved at runtime. Let's go back to the image. Saying that this service, it's not a class but an interface. Let's move it a bit higher up so there's room for the implementation. Then what this annotation and the field here says is that the sum clause requires an implementation of the service interface to be outer wired. The container must inject such an implementation. And that's all that's needed at compile time, right? Now we can compile the program. Then at runtime, the dependency must be resolved and an object of the implementing class is actually injected into sum clause and loaded into the IOC container. At compile time, when we write the program, we only declare that some class needs an implementation of the service interface, and at runtime, the IOC container will inject the implementation. So this IOC architecture also makes Spring powerful and flexible when it comes to interacting with external frameworks that are not a part of Spring. Say for example that this our sum class needs to call a database and we decide it will use JPA for that. Then say that we write a class called for example JPA resource that can interact with JPA and call a database. We won't have to write it, but as a starting point, let's say that we write such a class. And it's annotated outer wired. That means Spring will inject an object of JPA resource. And this JPA resource knows how to call JPA. So here is all the JPA implementation with entity managers and entity manager factories and everything. So just by creating such an object that can call the external API and inject that object, we have sort of injected the entire JPA. Calling JPA from our program now becomes as easy as inserting an outer-wired field. Okay, but it's even better. We don't have to write this JPA resource ourselves, because for many frameworks that are not part of Spring, there exists such objects. There are many Spring projects involved in integrating external frameworks in this way. Of course, this is also a bit of the complexity. Maybe you realize now that to set up the Spring environment, you have to inject loads of beans. This was one example. This bean was injected here. And you have to tie together lots of Spring frameworks and non-Spring frameworks by injecting beans into each other. So that makes Spring configuration somewhat complicated. That's why this Spring Boot project I mentioned previously was initiated. So that project will do a lot of this injection. These frameworks are glued together. More on that later in another video. Another issue here I should mention before we leave this is, where is JPA? This thing, it's inside the IOC container, but this JPA, should it be inside the IOC container or not? The thing is that objects created out here by JPA, for example entities, are not created by the IOC container, they are created by JPA. So we cannot use outerwired and stuff like that in JPA entities, because they are created by JPA and not by the IOC container. As you start developing Spring applications and they grow, you run into this every now and then. Objects are created by some external framework and not by the IOC container. So that's kind of a downside of the IOC container. It is not integrated inside the external frameworks like JPA. It just includes them. So you cannot use Spring annotations in objects created by external frameworks. Now we know the philosophy behind the IOC container and what it is used for. So let's look a bit more formally at how to define a bean and how to inject the bean. First of all, what are the requirements on a bean? There are very few requirements. Basically, a bean is any object that is instantiated by the IOC container. So as soon as the IOC container is aware of this object's existence, it becomes a bean. There are a few small requirements that we soon will see besides this. So there are different ways to declare the beans. Here we use the Java-based configuration. You can also declare the beans in an XML file, but we will not look at that. How does the IOC container know that this object is available as a bean and can be injected? There are basically two ways. Either the object is returned by a method that is annotated bean, and then the name of the bean becomes the name of the creating method. That method should be placed in a class that is annotated configuration. The bean factory populating the IOC container will look at all classes on the class path and see if there is any class annotated configuration that has methods annotated bean, and all objects returned by those methods will be considered beans. In this way, the bean is created by a method. We write the factory method, and that way we can also set values of fields in the bean, configure the bean. The other way is to make the class itself a prototype, and the object of the class can become a bean. That is done by annotating the class component. And remember that for an object to become a bean, it must be created by the IOC container, and that means the IOC container will call the constructor, and then the IOC container will have to pass all arguments to the constructor. So either it must be a no argument constructor, or it must have arguments that are auto-wired, and then the IOC container will inject all parameters. So either it is a method that creates any object, and the method, the creating method, is declared as a bean creator method, and then anything returned by the method is a bean, or it is the class that is a prototype for bean, and then all objects of that class becomes beans. The first way to create beans, the method way, is useful if you don't have the source code of the class, then you can't place an annotation of the class, or if you want to do some configuration of the class, for example set values of the fields and so on. And the other way, component annotation at the class, is useful if you have the source code of the class and you're not doing an external setup. So that's how to define a bean. So how to inject it into another bean? As we've seen, we use auto-wired to declare an injection point. And we can place the auto-wired annotation at the field, as we saw in the example, or constructor, as I just mentioned, or on the method. The bean is resolved by type, that is the class name or interface name. But it could be that there are multiple implementations of the declare type. If the type is an interface, there might be many implementing classes. Then we can use the qualifier annotation to resolve by name instead. To summarize, let's see how everything is tied together in this image. We already saw the IOC container previously. It's this thing here. The IOC container runs inside the servlet container. The Java servlet specification is not part of Spring, but of Java EE, and it basically defines the server. Java servlets is a specification specifying any request response based interaction, but there's also a lot of support for HTTP based request response interaction, which is what we will use. So there is a separate video that explains the servlet container, which is the host. The servlet container actually runs inside the actual server. So then inside the IOC container we have the Spring Web MVC framework, which is responsible for HTTP communication. The HTTP calls arrive at the Spring Web MVC framework that will interpret the request, make calls to the model, and through the model arrive at the database via JPA. Based on the outcome of the call to the model, a new HTML page should be created, and that is done by ThymeLeaf, which is strictly speaking not a Spring framework but is very much used in Spring Web applications. So ThymeLeaf is responsible for generating HTML pages, which are returned to the clients. So the clients are either browser-based clients which request HTML documents. Actually, that is the only client in the sample application. We could also have a web service client, for example, a mobile application, which would interact also over HTTP or HTTPS, perhaps doing RESTful web service calls. But there is no such thing in the sample application, but it would look quite similar to what there is. And then there is finally Spring Boot, which is responsible for starting the IOC container and the servlet container, and in fact also the server. So everything will be started by Spring Boot and tied together. And that is to simplify configuration of all the Spring frameworks and other frameworks that we are using. Even in this rather small application, as you will see, there is quite a lot of configuration. So the Spring Boot is really helpful to facilitate setting things up. Okay, so that was the overview of the Spring frameworks.